the walls thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. And when I think of God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. And died on the
weekend, we celebrate more than the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. We celebrate the exchange of our sins and our imperfections with the perfect and stainless sacrifice of Jesus Christ. In the thousands of years that has followed the crucifixion of Christ, we can still see the power of that sacrifice as generations of souls from all walks respond to the hope and message of salvation. Tonight, we are exploring the songs and testimonies of those transformed by the message of the cross. We look through the body of Christ to lift one another and to remind one another that no matter what our past is or what our trials are, that salvation is available to all and that we have nothing to fear because God the Father has called us His own. In Isaiah 43 and verse 1, the Lord says, "To fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called you by name. Thou art mine." It is through these testimonies and songs that we see this verse come to life. We see that God is good and faithful, and our souls sing out, "How great is our God!"
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before His feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard, as she poured her love for the Master from her box of alabaster. My praise on Him like oil for Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night He found me. You did not feel what I felt when He wrapped His love all around me. And you don't know the cause of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I spent my days, poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I'd found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of His touch. So now I'm giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love Him so. If I wash His feet with my tears and dry them with my hair, you were there the
I once was lost, but now I am found. A hymn that we all know and see ourselves in, just like in the author of Amazing Grace. John Newton was born in 1725. His mother was one of the only godly influences in his life, died just before he turned 7 years old. By the time he was 11, John Newton went to work as a sailor for his father, eventually becoming the captain of his own slave trading ship, where he captured, sold, and transported slaves from the West Indies and Africa to North America. Needless to say, cruelty was part of his everyday life. On March 10, 1978, while returning to England from Africa, there was a terrible storm, and John Newton believed that this would be his last voyage. The ship rocked back and forth, and with nothing else to do to survive, he picked up a book called The Imitations of Christ and began to read. It was from this experience that John Newton came to know Christ. For the next few years, he continued as a slave ship captain, trying to work and justify his work by holding church services with the crew, but he knew it wasn't right. He gave up his work and began to fight for the end of slavery. From the day he accepted Christ until the day he died in 1807, John Newton told others his story, that even though he made a lot of bad choices, God still loved him. Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Thank you.
that he knew would be called Calvary. Then he made the seed that would grow to be thorns that would make his son bleed. Then he made the green stem, gave it leaves, and then gave it sunshine and rain, and sheltered it with moss. He grew the tree he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing took his life, with love he gave it. He was crucified on the tree that he created. With great love for man, God stayed with his plan. He threw the tree so that we might go free. With tears in his eyes, God looked down through time, saw him spat upon, rejected and mocked. Still he grew the tree he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing took his life, with love he gave it. He was crucified on the tree that he created. With great love for man, God stayed with his plan. And he threw the tree so that we might go free. Yes, he grew the tree he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross.
From October 8th until the 10th, 1871, the Great Chicago Fire burned. Over 17,000 buildings were destroyed, 300 people killed, and more than 100,000 residents were left homeless. One of whom was Horatio Spafford, an attorney, real estate investor, and believer in Christ. Horatio Spafford had invested the majority of his wealth in real estate holdings along the shore of Lake Michigan, which were all lost in the Great Conflagration. Shortly after, he lost his only son to scarlet fever. Desiring a rest and respite for his family, Horatio Spafford planned an European trip for his four daughters and wife in 1873. Days before they were to leave, Horatio was called away on business and had to send his family ahead of him while he remained in Chicago, intending to set sail and catch up with his family in a few days. On November 22, 1873, the ship that carried Spafford's family was struck by an English steamship and sunk. Of the 313 people who departed on that ship, 226 were lost. A few days after hearing of the tragic accident, Spafford received a telegram from his wife. "Saved alone, what shall I do?" Spafford was heartbroken at the loss of all his children. With a heavy heart, he boarded the next ship to reunite with his wife. On his journey, Spafford reflected on his losses of wealth and of family and thought very deeply on how his faith and salvation played a role in his pain. As his ship passed the place of the accident, the captain stopped the vessel to pay homage to those who had lost their lives. Spafford looked out over the water and penned the words, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, and sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast thought me to say, it is well with my soul."
Psalms 104 verses 1 and 2 reads, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretches out the heavens like a tent." This scripture was written by King David II, King of Israel, who was known as the man after God's own heart. David had a long, prosperous life, but he had faced many hardships. King David ruled as king of the Israelites from approximately 1010 to 970 BCE. Before he became king, he was forced to run for his life, a victim of the snares of jealousy. During his reign, he lost many sons and his family was torn apart by greed and violence. Once again, he had to flee his kingdom to save his own life. David spent years in the wilderness holding on to God's promises. David did not just believe in God. He was fully aware of God's greatness, his majesty, and his goodness. But most of all, he was aware of how desperately he needed him, just as we all do. This scripture serves as a reminder that the one true living God, the Almighty One, who created the universe in all his majesty, allows us to take ownership and call him our God. It was from this reflection that a modern songwriter was inspired to write, "How Great is Our God." We can look at the life of David and his heart's response to the love of God through the Psalms and be encouraged in our own faith. The same God who empowered David to stand against a giant and protect him against armies cares for us. No matter what stage of life we are in, the things that stand against us tremble before his voice. We respond and declare that Jesus' name is the name above all names. He is worthy of our praise. We respond by singing, how great is our God. Thank you.
We have titled this evening, Then Sings My Soul. The stories and songs we have heard tonight chronicles songs that were written by people whose lives were highly impacted by the life and ministry and sacrifice of Jesus Christ.
Amazing Grace, a wayward son and a slave trader, learned of the wrong he took part in. With a repentant heart, he wrote the song, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound.
Wow, even the song that Bailey had played on the violin this evening, Pastor. My chains are gone. My God, my Savior, had ransomed me. Pastor, what do you think about those added lines? What do you think about John Newton? How you think he would respond to that?
I think he would love them. Honestly, it just shines a great truth on what John Newton had written about. And my, over about 300 years, that song continues to impact people's lives. You know, it's sung at funerals, it's sung at weddings, it's sung at special occasions. Amazing Grace, how sweet that sound. But I believe John Newton was impacted in a way which many of us can identify with. Because when we think about the life that he lived as a slave trader, his sinful lifestyle, the many things that he did, and how he treated people, he came to a realization that he was under eternal damnation.
True.
And now, coming to a realization of the life and sacrifice of Jesus Christ, that's why he could talk about the amazing grace of God. Amen. It not only sounds sweet, but it does something inwardly to us that brings transformation and cleansing. Okay, and that's what makes it so amazing. So to say, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has run. What profundity of truth is expressed there? It is so powerful.
Amazing.
Amen.
You know, one thing I've noticed about all these, about the stories, is that the authors did not write these songs for the congregation to sing. It was written for them for worship, for their personal salvation, and the way that they have surrendered their lives to God. So this is the reason why it wasn't about fame or popularity. It was all about worship.
Even that song that was sung this evening, How Great is Our God, it is taken from Psalm 104. Even Adi also have stated about King David, the trial he went through, Pastor. For about 17 years, he was on the run. He had to run for his life. He was destined for the throne to be king over Israel, but he was on the run. His life was at risk. Pastor, for someone to make so much a profound statement in the psalm, David wrote in Psalm 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. For someone to write those kind of a person like that must have a personal experience with the Creator himself, with Jehovah.
So true. His personal experience with God, in the triumphs of life, in the defeats that he faced, in the failures that were involved in his life. Yet, you know what's so profound about it? Every one becomes a song.
Wow.
In his loneliness, in his despair. You know, I think it's in Psalm 67, Hear my cry, O Lord, attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry to you. And when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. So for someone to face those challenges and yet have that response to God, amen, it's so profound.
Pastor, even in Psalm 1, he also wrote about the blessed man. And for to be blessed and be continued to be blessed, you had to be planted by the rivers of water.
Amen. And not only that, but the way he placed his faith in God. Can you think about Psalms 125, where he said, they that trust in the Lord shall be like Mount Zion, that cannot be removed, but abides forever. Wow. Then he goes on to say, as the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so is the Lord round about them that fear him, and delivers them. In Psalms 34, he would say, the angel of the Lord encamps around them that fear him. This comes from profound experience.
Confidence in someone that really know their Savior.
Amen.
Yeah, Pastor, for someone to make so much a profound statement in the book of Psalms, one must have a genuine experience with their Creator. I sure, Pastor, you have many testimony, but you can share with us one of your personal experience with your God.
Oh, it's which one? There are so many experiences, but
I can think of
an occasion where I went through a deep valley. You know, there is what we call the critical crossroads of life. That's when you are trying to transition from a teenager into adulthood. And you know, in adulthood, you are going to take on responsibilities now. The responsibility of a family, responsibility to employer, career, and everything like that. And one of them is thinking about getting married. And I know so many people have experiences. Amen. It was never smooth sailing. And so for me, I also had that awful experience of a broken engagement. And it's like your world falls apart. Yet right within that time when my world fell apart and I found myself in this deep valley, the words of a song, and I believe it was written by Fanny Crosby, and it says, all the way my Savior leads. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercies? Who through life has been a God being my guide through life? And then she finishes by saying, for I know whatever befalls me, Jesus do it, all things well. And you know, as we reflect tonight on John Newton, okay, my chains are gone, I've been set free. I love the original version that John Newton wrote. There's a verse that we don't sing today, but it says, the Lord has promised good to me. His word my hope secures. He will my shield and comfort be as long as life endures. Oh my, that's so powerful. Amen. And when you can truly experience God, it has such profound impact upon your life that you are going all the way to the journey's end. And all the way, Jesus is leading. Uh-huh. But you know, brother, you know, my brother, we all have experiences, and your background is so different from mine. I grew up in a Christian family, but you came from a Muslim background. There must have been what we call a defining moment, a turning point, when you saw religion for what it was and faith in Christ as something being different. Could you share something about that?
You know, coming from a Muslim background, I took my religion very serious. Very serious. But there was a void within my heart. There was emptiness. I was hungry for something that only God could have satisfied there. In my village, there was a crusade, Pastor, Sister Indra. I was invited, I went, normal. The message that was preached that evening, it impacted my life. After hearing that message, it brings conviction to my heart. That sin nature has to be dealt with. The pastor said, who want to accept Christ Jesus and to repent from your sins, come up to the altar. I went up to the altar. I say the sinner's prayer. I was genuine.
You experienced salvation.
I accept Christ as my Savior, and I experience salvation.
And the joy of forgiveness.
And the joy of forgiveness, it transformed, it impacted me, my life, from inside out. When I went home to pray to my Jesus, when I got on my knees and I closed my eyes, I could have actually see idols in front of me, that image. And the voice, I heard the voice saying to me, that thing what you're going up there for is not for you. It is only for them. So I say to myself, if it make me feel so good, and the joy and the bliss that it give to me, if it's good for them, it's good for me also. So there was war. The next day, crusade, I went up again to the altar because it made me feel so good. You know, time for baptism. Now I went to baptize, and when I came home, my father told me, get out from the house. What I did, I questioned him. I said, what you say? Get out from the house. You know what he said? He said, I never tell you get out of the house. You see, I stand up. There was boldness.
Yes.
There was boldness.
Amen.
And from that day until now, Pastor, my eyes are open. Okay. I could identify with John Newton. I was blind.
But now I see.
But now I see.
Amen. Amen.
Sister Indra, I came from a Muslim background, from dead works to serve the living God. You came from Hinduism. Can you share with us how you came to faith in Jesus?
Well, Brother Ali, you were just told to get out of the house. I think mine was more fear. But I'll tell you a little bit of my experience growing up in a Hindu home. You know, both parents are Hindus, and you know, we go to the Hindu temple. We have Hindu prayers in our yard for like 7 days. We have all this stuff happening, and you know, but as children, my parents would send us to Sunday school. How strange is that? So they had a little bit of belief in Jesus because they send us to Sunday school. So as siblings, we all go to Sunday school. We sing the songs. We were taking part in plays and, you know, all of this happening. But, you know, we sometimes we wonder. Nothing is by accident. You know that.
Exactly.
God has a plan and a purpose for all our lives.
Amen.
You see, growing up, common entrance time, all my siblings passed common entrance and went to, you know, school that was free. But unfortunately, I didn't. But God had a plan. You know, I ended up going to a private school, Open Bible High School. And I think, you know, religious knowledge was one of the subjects that we had to take. And learning about the Bible and Jesus and taking part, going to chapel every Friday. And, you know, it sort of instilled something in me. And I wanted more of it. And my sister, she had already accepted the Lord and she was going to church. So I started following her to church. But as I said, God had a plan for my life. And I give my heart to the Lord. But the thing is, Brother Ali, you know, time for baptism, you know, I went through this baptism class and thought, okay, well, I am going to, you know, get baptized and everything. Day for baptism, I didn't show up, you know? You know, I was asked why, you know, but you make some kind of excuse, you know, you couldn't come and that, whatever. So I went through a couple more classes and baptism rolls around and I didn't show up, you know, but something, you know, I keep going because there was something, there was a hunger, you know, I wanted more. And the reason why I never showed up, it was fear. And many times fear can hold us back from many things.
In prison.
So, this time I said, I made up my mind. I said, you know what, I'm going through with this. And the third time I went to the baptism classes and went to the day came, and I did show up and got baptized. And I just got rid of the old me. Praise God, you know. Jesus leads us all the way, amen? And nothing is by accident. And you know, I give God thanks because since that day, I've never turned back. And to be, you know, to look at the blessing that God has bestowed upon our lives, it's unbelievable. But we serve a great God.
Amen.
Amen. One act of sacrifice he did on that cross, one act. And it affected many, many people in years, in thousands of years to follow. Tonight, all these songs that were sung tonight, you know, I want to encourage all our viewers tonight to take it personal. Take it personal. And if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, make a decision tonight if you would like to follow Him as your Lord and Savior.
Nothing compares to your love. How could I measure your heart? Right from the start, you always loved me. When I was far away, when I was deep in the valley, wherever I hid, you always found me. There's never been anyone quite like you. No one loves me the way you do. How can I thank you? How can I thank you? Nothing compares to your love. How could I measure your heart? Right from the start, you always loved me. When I was far away, when I was deep in the valley, wherever I hid, you always found me. There's never been anyone quite like you. No one loves me the way you do. How can I thank you?
They say this mountain can't be moved. They say these chains will never break. But they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. We believe, God, we believe.
We have been talking about the stories and testimonies of souls responding to the message of the cross. We declare our faith and the goodness of God as He accepts us just as we are. And we give thanks that God sent His Son for us. Tonight, we declare and believe that our God is still saving. He is still performing miracles. He is loving. And He is faithful. Tonight we declare it and we believe for it. Tonight we're going to bow our heads in prayer, thanking God. Heavenly and righteous eternal Father, Lord, we give you thanks for salvation. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of salvation that was purchased on the cross of Calvary 2,000 years ago. Lord, I pray for needs. I pray you're going to meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Lord, you are Jehovah Jireh. You will meet that financial need, dear Holy Father. Lord, I pray also for the health of the church, the health of people, the health, dear Holy God. You said you wish above all that we prosper and be in good health even as our soul prospereth, dear Holy Father. I pray for families, Lord. Lord, I pray that families will come back together, dear Holy Father. Lord, we declare the promises of God over our lives. Holy Father, I ask this blessing in no other name but the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. As we declare and revel in the goodness of God, we give thanks to our God for the work that was done over 2,000 years ago. We invite you to worship with us in song as we give thanks for Jesus Christ's perfect sacrifice and affirm that He is worthy of our praise.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Me in your cleansing flow. Now all I worthy is the Lamb.